One name is higher.
Welcome to Prescott 83 Sunday Morning Worship Service with Pastor Vince Diegler.
Chapter 6 this morning, and Paul is continuing his explanation of Christian theology. Remember, the Church of Rome, a little bit different origin. It didn't start in a traditional way, Paul coming to town, planning the church, organizing the church, and all that. This church kind of evolved through migration and affinity, and so he's writing to them so that they have a good, solid foundation underneath them. And if you remember, he started the epistle, chapters 1 to 3, with a focus on condemnation. Romans 3:23 says, all of us human beings are sinners. We fall short of the glory of God. And he starts there because that explains why salvation is necessary. He immediately then moved to the subject of justification, how you and I, who are sinners, are able to have a righteous standing before God. And Paul makes a very clear point here. He makes it clear that salvation is not available any other way than through the grace of God and by putting our faith in Jesus Christ. Now, you would think that hearing that kind of news would result in two things. First of all, a big sigh of relief. You mean to tell me I don't have to earn my way? I don't have to somehow do enough good deeds to be worthy of God's grace? So a sigh of relief, followed by a joyous celebration, because grace says that God has done for me what I could never do for myself. So you would think that would be celebrated. And the reality is, from the very beginnings of Christianity, grace has been controversial. And even today, it's often misunderstood. There are a lot of people that look at grace and they see it as undermining the whole idea of living a righteous life. Because they say, well, you don't need to be righteous. God's grace kind of undermines that need. And so they feel threatened by it. They think in some way grace greenlights ungodly living. And in our study back in chapter 3, we saw that we've already touched on that. And we're going to touch on it again here in chapter 6. And the reality is that kind of thinking could not be further from the truth. But it's a fallacy. It's an error that has to be addressed. And so what Paul does, and this is very important, what Paul does is he confronts that error by explaining the next step in our spiritual journey. We go from condemnation to justification. Now we're going to sanctification. It's the next step in our spiritual journey, and it's Paul's response. Shall we continue in sin that grace can increase? And he says, no way. Because God's grace opens the door for spiritual transformation. It does not promote godless living. It promotes the transformation that the Spirit of God brings into our lives from the inside out. And here's why that's important. When we understand Holy Spirit transformation, we're going to resist some of the urges of religion. I've often compared religion, and I'll use the word legalism. Do y'all know what a bonsai tree is? These are little itty-bitty trees. And they're little itty-bitty trees because their growth is intentionally stunted. And that's what religion tends to do. It's afraid of what we are capable of. And so it's like, okay, I'm going to put a bunch of rules and regulations on you. And in doing that, I'm going to protect you from yourself. And it's like that bonsai tree. Immediately you're stunted. When you understand God's grace and the process of sanctification, you're going to reject those kind of shackles, and you're going to invite the Holy Spirit to transform you from the inside out. And that's what we're going to focus in on this morning. So let's get started. We're going to begin in verses 1 to 5. What shall we say then? And he's building off of what he's just covered in chapter 5. What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning that grace may increase? His answer, by no means. We are those who have died to sin. How can we live in sin any longer? Or don't you know that all of us who are baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may have a new life. For if we've been united with him in death like his, in a death like his, we will certainly also be united with him in a resurrection like his. Now, what Paul is pointing out is that spiritual formation is rooted in our union with Christ, which is what he's picturing. He talks about being baptized into Christ. That's spirit baptism, where basically the moment we put our faith in Jesus Christ, here's what happens. The Holy Spirit takes us and unites us with Jesus Christ in a permanent, forever union. That is true of us. That's true of everyone else that puts their faith in Christ. We become a part of the body of Christ. That's what he's talking about. And in that process of becoming a part of the body of Christ, the first point Paul makes is we died to sin. Look at verse 2. They raise the question, shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Paul says, by no means, no way, that's stupid. We are those who died to sin. Question we need to ask is, well, what does that mean, we died to sin? Well, fortunately for us, Paul explains it. Let's keep reading. Don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism in death, into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead for the glory of the Father, we too may walk and live in newness of life. So what is Paul saying here? He's building off of what he just covered in chapter 5. If you remember there, he was comparing what was true because of our relationship with Adam. Because Adam sinned, sin was transferred, and we were infected, and all of humanity that's connected to Adam became sinners, and sin results in spiritual death. So that he's talking about the impact of Adam. Sin and death reigned over humanity. But in Jesus Christ, because Christ paid for sin in full, and because he rose from the dead, we can be reconciled to God, and we can experience new life in Christ. That's God's grace. God doing for us what we could not do for ourselves, what we could never be worthy of or deserving of. Now remember, grace threatens the Jews. They think somehow that undermines the law. We don't need the law if we can be saved by grace. That's their thinking. So they raise the question, shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? And Paul says, no, that's silly. And he points out, we are those who died to sin. And what he means is this, the old Vince, the old you, the moment you turned to Jesus Christ and trusted him. That old Vince is gone. That Vince that was related to Adam, that Vince that was dominated by sin, that guy is gone. When we accepted Christ, a heavenly transaction took place. My sin was put on Jesus. His righteousness was put on me. So that in looking at this passage, what is described is spirit baptism, which is pictured by water baptism. So then in Jesus Christ, and then there's our baptismal tank right here. So if you think about the process of being baptized, in Jesus Christ I died and was buried. I'm put under the water. We don't keep you there. We bring you up, just like Jesus rose from the dead. And Paul's making the point, death is necessary. You can't rise from the dead if you've not first died, right? So Jesus died, Jesus was buried, then Jesus rose from the dead. And as he rises from the dead, he's conquering sin, he's conquering death, so that he is able to offer us new life. And he's saying, everything that was true of Christ because of our union with Christ, the old Vince died, the old Vince was buried, a new Vince emerges, capable of experiencing the life that God always intended. I am able to experience newness of life in Jesus Christ. So Paul starts in Christ because of that union with him. I died to sin. In Christ, I experience new life. Now, let's go back to verse 4 again. If you look at the last word in the second line and the first two words of the third line, they don't look all that important, but they really are. We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death in order that. What you need to understand is that's a purpose clause. What he's saying is the whole idea of death and burial has a purpose. What is that purpose? We go back. So that we can participate in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's the analogy he's making. In order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may have good life. If the old Vince is still alive, how is it possible for a new Vince to be alive at the same time? It can't. That's why the old Vince has to go. The old Vince has to go. He is incompatible with the life that God wants me to experience. So my choice is, well, I can hang on to the old life and I could do that forever. Or I can give my life to Jesus Christ. What does that mean? That means the old Vince has to go and a new Vince has to emerge. The Vince that God designed. There's a purpose there, and the purpose is so that you and I can experience resurrection living, the life that God intends. If you go back to chapter 5, when he's talking about the impact of Adam's sin, he talks about how sin and death had reigned over humanity. But when he gets to the effect of Jesus Christ, he says, now grace reigns, now righteousness reigns, now life to its full reigns. And at this point in Paul's letter, I want you to think of this as foundational truth. I need to know this so that I can experience the life God intends for me. Truth is important. But there is a catch, because truth is only as good as our application of that truth into our lives. For instance, We're all familiar with the law of gravity, right? Okay. I know about the law of gravity. If I don't apply what I know, I could get in trouble. Every now and then, I have to go up on a ladder to clean my gutters. We've got a couple palm trees. I shouldn't say this because I'll never hear the end. I'm a stupid back east guy who never was around palm trees and thought palm trees are really cool. I'm going to plant some palm trees in my yard. Palm trees grow, and they are messy. And I got to go up on a big old ladder with a big old pole with a saw on the end of it and cut that mess more than I want to. And every time I go up that ladder, I have a healthy respect for the law of gravity because I know you lose your balance. You cannot fly, Vince. You cannot fly. If I could fly, I wouldn't have a ladder. I would just levitate and cut the branches off, and it wouldn't be a problem. I can't fly. No matter how I try, I cannot fly. When I go up a ladder, I have a healthy respect for the law of gravity. Basically, Paul's saying, here's the truth you have to know. If you're going to experience the life God wants for you, you've got to know this, but that truth is only as good as your application of it. And so we're going to continue where I think Paul basically is making that point. So he says, when we look at our life in Christ, where grace reigns and righteousness reigns and we experience life to its very full, that's rooted in our union with Jesus Christ. But then a process begins where we start growing because we don't immediately become the men and women God wants us to be. That takes place over the rest of our lives. So let's read what Paul writes, starting in verse 6, for we know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body that was ruled by sin might be done away with, that we could no longer be slaves to sin. Because anyone who has died has been set free from sin. Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. For we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he can't die again. Death no longer has any mastery over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. And in the same way, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Jesus Christ. Therefore, don't let sin reign in your mortal body so that you obey its evil desires. Instead, or do not offer any part of yourself to sin as an instrument of wickedness, but instead offer yourself to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and offer every part of yourself to him as an instrument of righteousness. For sin shall no longer be your master, because you're not under the law, you are under grace. Now, what Paul is doing here is he's further explaining what he's just said. There's certain things we have to know if we're going to experience life to its full. So that's where he begins. Here's what we have to know. The old you, the old me, we'll call it the old self, has been crucified with Christ. Now, obviously, he's not talking about a physical reality, because if he were, well, then we would be dead. He's talking about a spiritual reality. It's a similar point to what he made with the Galatians. In Galatians chapter 2, verse 20, he says, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. I'm alive. But it's not really me. It is Christ who is living in me, and Christ who is living through me. So the life I now live, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. It's the exact same point, but he's explaining why that's important. The reason we died is so that we'd no longer be enslaved. The moment a slave died, what was true? He's no longer a slave. He's been released from that slavery. And the point Paul's making is that individual has been set free. Any concerns of life end the moment you die. Now they become very real for the people attached to you. For instance, if you owe someone $250,000 and you die, guess what? Not your problem. Anybody that was attached to you, now it's their problem, but you've been set free. Any concerns whatsoever, death separates you from that concern. And Paul's point is, he's talking about the power of sin in our life. We all are tempted, right? We all have weaknesses. You know what a dead person doesn't have? Any of that. They don't have desires, whether they're good, whether they're dead. And that kind of thing ends. That's the point Paul is making, and he's pointing out that that's necessary because that death precedes being resurrected with Jesus Christ, experiencing new life with him, so that just like Christ rose from the dead, we rise with him to experience new life. And everything that Paul describes as being true of Jesus is now true of us. For instance, he points out Christ can't die again. I can physically die, but there's a reason why the life Christ offers us is called eternal life. My physical death is not the end of my existence. It's simply the end of this physical body. But Christ has given me eternal life. So that the Bible says, the moment I breathe my last breath here, to be absent from this body is what? To be present with the Lord, where I will live with him forever. Christ can't die anymore. Guess what? Neither can I. Death has no mastery over Jesus, nor me. Because he died a once and for all death. And made a once and for all payment for sin. And when he rose from the dead, I participated in that by faith. And now sin and death are defeated. And they no longer have any power in my life. That's the truth that Paul's trying to convey that they need to know. You've been crucified with Christ. You're dead to sin, you're alive to God. But what did we say? That truth is only as good as my application of that truth. So that's what Paul kind of hammers on. In the same way, count yourself dead to sin, but alive to God. He's calling the Romans to apply that truth. And I think he's addressing a problem that is still very real today. We talk about new life in Christ, right? Here's the problem. I experienced new life in Christ in the same old body I was born with. I live on the same planet that I was born into, amongst the same people that have been around me my entire life. So yeah, I have new life in Christ, but I have it in a body that's broken, in a world that's broken, and I share with other people, and every single one of them are broken. Everything I've ever known in this universe has been marred by sin. And here's what that means. I am dead to sin, but sometimes I don't feel very dead to sin. Sometimes I feel very alive to sin. In fact, sometimes I would much rather sin than do something right. I've told you before, I've got a problem with customer service representatives. They know how to push my buttons better than anyone on the planet. And it starts with, "I'm sorry, Mr. Degler, for the trouble you're having." I did not call for an apology. I don't care if you're sorry or not. I want one thing and only one thing, and I want it quick. Fix whatever I'm calling about. They just drive me nuts. And sometimes when they push the right button, Jesus could be sitting next to me and say, "Vince, choose your next words carefully," and I'd say, "Shut up." Because I don't want to say a Jesus-like thing. I want to say a Vince-like thing. I want you to know what I'm thinking right now. I want to put the fear of God in you. I don't know if you ever have those kinds of feelings, but I do. I know the Bible says I'm dead to sin, but sometimes I think I've been resurrected to sin. Do you know Paul had that same problem? We're going to get to it in the next chapter. In Romans chapter 7, Paul is very open and he says, "There's a lot of good things that I want to do, and you know what? I don't do any of them. And there's a lot of bad stuff I don't want to do, and I keep doing it anyway." And he cries out, "Oh, wretched man that I am, who will deliver me?" What's he talking about? He's talking about the fact that I may be dead to sin, but this body isn't dead. And this world I live in isn't dead. And the people I'm around aren't dead. And there's a lot of influence that can arouse, even though I'm dead, can arouse me to sin. And then there's the opposite side of the coin. The Bible says I'm alive to God. But sometimes I feel spiritually lifeless. I feel God is distant. I feel God is silent. I find no joy in. I have no interest in the things of God. There's sometimes when I just don't care. And I think just about every Christian who's ever walked this planet has moments just like that. And Paul is basically saying this. Don't live out of your feelings. The Bible says you are dead to sin. You may not always feel dead to sin. That doesn't change the fact you're dead to sin. You may not always feel like you're alive to God, but the Bible makes it clear you are alive to God. Don't live out of your feelings. Live out of correct biblical thinking. You are dead to sin. You are alive to God, and it may not feel that way in this moment, but count it to be true and live as if it is true. And the way you do that is quite simple, and Paul explains it for us. It starts with dethroning sin. When our relationship with Adam dominated our life, sin reigned. But now, because of our union with Christ, the Bible tells us we're dead to sin and we're alive to God. So instead of yielding to our sinful impulses, Paul would say, just say no. One of the things, And this will sound screwy, but I recommend it anyway. I recommend talking to your TV, and I recommend talking to yourself. So that when in your mind you start feeling like you're being attracted and enticed towards doing whatever is wrong. I've told you before, when I know I have to call a customer service representation before I ever pick up the phone, I pray. Because I know they're going to push my buttons, and I start praying. It's like, I want to do the right thing. I don't want to do the wrong thing. And so I need all the help I can get before they start pushing my button. So I pray. And it would be really wise if in those moments when they're pushing my buttons that I would just point out to myself, wait a minute, Vince, you're dead. You're dead to that. When Satan comes and tempts, Satan, I'm dead. That guy you're looking for, he doesn't live here anymore. He's gone. He's dead. He's buried. And this guy that you're talking to right now is not controlled by you. This guy's controlled by God. That's what basically Paul's saying. Dethrone sin, enthrone God. Let him be your master. When we get to chapter 12, Paul's going to talk about becoming living sacrifices. I think the point grows out of this text that we're looking at right now. Offer yourself to God as an instrument of righteousness. See yourself as a tool, an instrument in God's hands with which he wants to do. God wants to be and is very much involved in our world. And he does that in many ways. But one of the ways he's most desirous of is to do that through you and me. He wants to use me as an instrument of righteousness. And I need to yield to him. I need to give myself to him to do that. That's why I often describe the simplicity of life as just do the next right thing. Whatever the next thing is that God wants you to do, just do that. And you string together enough next right things and you are on your way to experiencing the kind of life God intended. Basically, what Paul's saying is make yourself a servant of God so that he's controlling as opposed to sin controlling. Let me try to wrap this up for the day. When I look at what Paul says, there's a part of me says, I do not understand why in the world the Jews would be threatened by grace. It doesn't make any sense for me. I see it completely differently. For instance, look at Titus 2. The grace of God that offers salvation has appeared to everyone. And it teaches us something. Look at what it teaches us. To say no to ungodliness, to say no to worldly passion, to live a self-controlled, upright, and godly life. Look at another verse. For it is by grace you've been saved through faith. It's not of yourselves, it's a gift of God, not of works, so that no one can boast. And grace is the mechanism by which we become God's handiwork. It's through grace that we are recreated in Christ Jesus with the express purpose that we are now designed to do the good works which God prepared in advance for us to do. I don't know how you see grace as a threat to godless living. I see grace as the biggest mechanism to promote godly living. It teaches us to deny ourselves. It teaches us to live godly lives. It teaches us, and it's the mechanism by which we become the handiwork of God to do good works. And that is true because the moment we give our lives to Jesus Christ, a process begins, and the Holy Spirit begins to recreate me, and step by step, day by day, little by little, make me more and more like Jesus. And all Paul's saying here in this text is, here's the truth you need to know. You've been crucified with Christ. You still are physically alive. But the life that you now live should be controlled and dominated by the Holy Spirit of God. Allow Christ to live in you and through you. There'll be times in a broken world where that doesn't seem true. Ignore it. Don't live out of your feelings. Don't live out of your sentiment. Live out of the concrete fact that you're dead to sin and alive to God. How do I do that? By making myself God's servant. Instead of constantly turning myself over to the mastery of sin, make myself the servant of God. Allow him to lead and direct me to do whatever he has before me. Take that next step. Do that next right thing. And slowly but surely, day by day, you will become more and more like Jesus. Can we pray together? Father, there's a lot of stuff in the Bible that seems complicated, that seems difficult to grasp. I thank you for the simplicity that Paul shares here. I don't understand all of my feelings and all of my thoughts and why sometimes we have the desires we have and the interests we have and the passions we have. I don't necessarily understand all that, but I can understand concrete terms like death and life. I can understand a term like count it to be so. And I know what it means to yield. And in a very simple way, you have shown us how we can be the men and women you want us to be and how we can experience the life that you've always intended for us. And it starts with God's grace. And through God's grace, we have a permanent union with Christ. And in that union, the old Vince died. The old Vince has been buried. And I need to remember that, and I need to keep him in the tomb so that the new Vince defines me. And Father, I want that to be true for every one of us. That we would live out of the new self and not the old. So I pray, just as Paul wrote these words, that this truth would be etched in our minds and we'd count it to be so. So that as we live our lives, we would constantly be yielding ourselves to you as instruments of righteousness, seeing ourselves as a tool in your hand so that you can work not just in us but through us to make our lives and to make our world what you want them to be. Help us to do that, Father. I thank you for this passage and the challenge it holds. The truth is only as good as our application, so may we apply it to the praise of your glory. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.